Thank you so much. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
So let me begin by thanking Dean Morrison for this extraordinary opportunity, and by extending my greetings and thanks as well to President Sexton, to the faculty, deans, and staff of the law school. Congratulations to David and Stephanie for those wonderful remarks. And of course, my congratulations to you, the graduates of the class of 2014. What an extraordinary day for you. Now, this is most improbable, that I would be giving the convocation address at NYU Law School. I am the youngest of 10 children, born to Lester and Myrtle Ifill, who put education above all, although neither had more than a high school education. And although I dreamed of being a civil rights lawyer from the time I was a little girl, I'd never met a lawyer until I arrived at NYU in the late summer of 1984. My first class that August day was civil procedure with Professor Samuel Estreicher. He was talking about something called personal jurisdiction. I had no idea what he was talking about that day, or the next day, or the one after that. Professor Estreicher was, and I suspect still is, not a handholder. He was tough, very tough, a little intimidating. But we were about 3 weeks into the course when the day of revelation came, and civil procedure, the sky suddenly opened for me. It wasn't even one of the big cases. It was a little case out of Illinois, Gray versus American Radiator. I hear snickers from civil procedure folks in the back. Without any warning and for no particular reason, the entire doctrine made sense to me, fully, excitingly made sense, and my love affair with procedure began. I must say it's intimidating to stand before many of my former professors, men and women whose work, teaching, and scholarship I have looked up to over the years, like Professor Caldwell and Professor Law and Professor Hertz, Professor Guggenheim and Professor Newborn, and too many to mention. NYU Law School has also been home to some of the most brilliant, innovative LDF lawyers, including Anthony Amsterdam and one of my mentors, Derek Bell. I'm also thrilled to acknowledge the presence of three law school classmates of mine who became my very best friends: Gemma Solimene, now a professor at Fordham Law School; Ricardo Castro, general counsel of one of the largest philanthropic foundations in the world, the Ford Foundation; and Maria Perez Brown, a trailblazing and highly successful entertainment lawyer and producer. And I'd also like to acknowledge the presence of my husband, Ivo Knobloch, who, although he was a German national, spent a fair amount of time at the law school with me at Mercer Street in my third year. And we've now been married for 26 years. Now, if I recall correctly from my own law school graduation 23 years ago, you are not at all interested in what I'm about to say. But I will press on anyway. You can follow me on Twitter if that's what you're doing, and tweet kind things about what I'm saying. But there is something I wish to share with you, and it's of a piece with the remarks made by Dean Morrison and President Sexton and by your two student speakers. I want to remind you that you're graduating in a year filled with historical significance and anniversaries. It's the 50th anniversary of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. It's the 50th anniversary of Freedom Summer. And it's the 60th anniversary of the Supreme Court's decision in Brown versus Board of Education. In fact, we celebrated Brown Day just this past weekend. And as you know, Brown was the case litigated by lawyers at the NAACP Legal Defense Fund and led by my predecessor, the first Director-Counsel of LDF, Thurgood Marshall. I'm sure you've read and studied Brown in your con law class. I certainly hope you did. Because I think that so many of us, not just lawyers and law students, but Americans, fail to recognize the significance of this case. Brown was the most important constitutional moment of the 20th century. Lewis Pollack, the former dean of Yale Law School and federal judge and great, great friend of LDF, did not exaggerate when he described Brown as, quote, probably the most important governmental act of any kind since the Emancipation Proclamation. It's important to understand what really happened on May 17, 1954. The Supreme Court outlawed segregation in education, and in so doing articulated the full and equal citizenship of black people. The decision was a recognition that segregation had been maintained for the purpose of subordinating black people, for the purpose of denying blacks the full citizenship to which they were entitled with the passage of the 14th Amendment in 1868. Brown was the beginning of the end of legal apartheid in this country and an opening salvo to the civil rights movement. Brown was not just for black people. Brown was a gift to America. It allowed America for the first time to begin to look at itself in the mirror. What that means for us sitting here today in all of our diversity, in all of our cosmopolitan sophistication, what that means is that this country, as you and I have been privileged to know it, you for all of your lives, and me as well, is less than 60 years old. As a society in which the principle of equality has true legal meaning, a society without a legally enforced racial caste system, we are less than 60 years old. We must remember this, you and I, for two reasons. The first is that remembering this keeps us from becoming impatient and frustrated with our frequent national missteps and mistakes. We are still relatively new at this thing called equality. We are still feeling our way. America is, in essence, an equality teenager. And you remember how you were when you were a teenager. Given to outbursts of frustration and anger, questioning and not fully appreciating the values that shape you, engaging in magical and grandiose thinking, believing that you can be successful without hard work, and underneath it all, insecurity and fear about the future. This is America when it comes to race and equality. We're immature, but most assuredly, we are growing up. We should remember how new we are to this because it helps us understand the contradictions we see around us every day. The relative newness of this post-Brown country explains why we can simultaneously have a black president and a Donald Sterling. It is not, as some have said, because we are going backwards. It is precisely because we are going forward, and because that way forward is new and uncharted territory for this country, that our conflicts have arisen. The second reason we must remember our relative youth as a nation free of legal apartheid is because today I cannot release you. As much as I would like to release you to embark on a successful career in which you make a name for yourself and lots of money, I cannot release you from your obligation to engage in the work of perfecting this democracy. It is just too soon. As you've heard from Dean Morrison, as a lawyer, you are a leader. You're an officer of the court, but also a leader of our nation. You may not want to be a leader. You may not even deserve it. But this is the privilege and burden imposed on us when we become lawyers. People will look to you for answers. You will have knowledge and insights about the working of our government, our courts, and public policy that others do not have. You will know how to navigate complex systems. You will have friends and clients in both high and low places. You will be better equipped than the average American to make a difference, and you will make a difference. The question you must grapple with is, what kind of difference do you want to make? Now, I don't want to pressure you too much. You needn't make that difference tomorrow. By all means, pass the bar exam first. And be sure that you do not overextend yourself in your early years. Work hard and learn your craft in whatever field of law you choose. But understand this, you are called to be a civil rights lawyer. Because civil rights work is the work of democracy maintenance. It is not work to be done only by black lawyers, or women lawyers, or gay lawyers, or even those of us who have committed ourselves to this practice full time. It is every lawyer's obligation to engage in the hard but necessary work of democracy maintenance. And you know how it is with maintenance. Sometimes you need to just do some sprucing up. Sometimes you need to refurbish that which has grown shabby and worn. Sometimes you have to rip out whole sections and build anew. Sometimes you must go to the very foundations and reinforce them. And I don't think you need me to tell you today that in America today, we need to do some foundational work. When America has become a place where leaders in our country can be openly engaged in the effort to discourage or prevent other Americans from voting, and when the highest court in our land removes the protections afforded those voters, we need to do foundational work. When we have incarcerated 2 million people, many for non-violent drug offenses, hollowing out communities and families, we need to do foundational work. When we become more and more segregated and live in separate racial and economically stratified communities, we need to do some foundational work. When a country of immigrants has relegated more than 1.5 million young people who came to this country as children to live in the shadows because they lack documentation, we must do foundational work. And when there's still no federal law and no law in a majority of our states that prohibits employment discrimination based on sexual orientation, we have some foundational work to do. So I'm not asking all of you to join the Legal Defense Fund. Okay, some of you, yes, I would like you to join the Legal Defense Fund. But really, I mean that being a civil rights lawyer should infuse your conception of your professional self. I'm betting that it already does. Let's be honest, it was LDF and lawyers like Thurgood Marshall and Jack Greenberg and Constance Baker Motley who made it cool to be a lawyer. We pioneered the concept of the attorney who, for little pay but with excellence, preparation, conviction, and cool, rattles our republic and holds up the mirror to our ideals and speaks powerfully to those who are powerless. It's not all myth. You can really do that. Even if it's not your job every day, take seriously your obligation to do pro bono work. This is not an obligation that should feel like a burden. It is your democracy maintenance time, and we need you. Some of you may be discouraged by recent events involving confirmation hearings in Washington, D.C. You may be thinking, maybe I shouldn't represent defendants on death row. Maybe I shouldn't represent Guantanamo detainees. Maybe I shouldn't represent unpopular clients. But this whole profession is imperiled when lawyers, we, who are at the top of the professional food chain, allow fear and personal ambition to stand ahead of our obligation to vindicate the rights set out in the Constitution on behalf of our clients, whoever they may be. And don't be scared off. This will not be as hard as it seems. Many will tell you that you don't have time to do pro bono work, or that doing that work won't help you make partner. Some of you will be told that you can't be a public interest lawyer and eat. I understand the press of student loan debt. I was the youngest and am the youngest of 10 children. I could never have attended law school without serious student loans, which is why I am here today thanking Margie Quillones. Where is she in academic affairs? The Schwed loan, very important. I have no regrets. It took me until I was in my 40s to repay my student loans. But I have no regrets. Selling my brownstone in Brooklyn in the 1990s, that I regret. But this career, never. These are false choices, pro bono or partner, motherhood or tenure. Women, I shouldn't have to address special remarks to you, but I feel compelled to do so because this week the First Lady of New York was criticized and called a bad mother because she gave a Thoughtful magazine interview in which she admitted to deep ambivalence about leaving her career for motherhood after the birth of her first child. I understood Ms. McRae's candid explanation of her feelings in the first years of motherhood. I, after all, weaned my eldest daughter so that I could do my first oral argument in the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals. No regrets. I don't recommend it, but no regrets. At the same time, there's no greater joy in my life, no moment when viscerally at the very center of me, I'm not thinking about and loving my three extraordinary and amazing daughters. 1 million sacrifices have been willingly and gladly made for them. Would my daughters be more extraordinary if they'd been nursed for a full year? It's hard to imagine. But really, is this the level at which we're judging ourselves and being judged? And by the way, I killed at that argument. I still think it was my best. That's why, with all due respect to Sheryl Sandberg and Arianna Huffington and Claire Shipman, and all of the other women whom I greatly admire, who admonish us to lean in and thrive and sleep 9 hours and be confident, my advice to you is against listening to advice about how to do womanhood. Just do you. You're a woman, you're going to be criticized for it anyway. Later this year or next, you'll take an oath to uphold the Constitution. It's the same oath that Charles Hamilton Houston and Thurgood Marshall and Constance Baker Motley and Derrick Bell did before you. These were great pioneering civil rights lawyers. But when they took the oath to uphold the Constitution, they were not even considered equal citizens in the country of their birth. When Constance Baker Motley litigated school desegregation cases in the South, one judge turned his chair and kept his back to her during her entire presentation. The local newspaper referred to her as that Motley woman. Even though the Constitution did not work for them, they took seriously their obligation to uphold its terms and its spirit and to lead this country into its better self. We must do this too. And you are not freed of this obligation simply because you are a patent lawyer, or a securities lawyer, or a family lawyer, or in the JAG Corps. So my hope for all of you today is that you will become my partners, my colleagues in civil rights work, that you will infuse your practice in whatever field it might be with the ethic of equality and opportunity, that you will make time to do pro bono work, that you will be great criminal defense attorneys, prosecutors, academics, that you will support the work of those of us who have devoted our lives to democracy maintenance full time, that we will all work together as civil rights lawyers, that you will join that overflowing roster of NYU law graduates who are recognized for their innovation, commitment, and leadership in making this great but flawed democracy better. But all of this begins tomorrow. Today is a day of celebration, a day to thank your extraordinary parents, to thank grandparents and spouses, a day to thank mentors and that special faculty member who inspired you, and a day to rejoice at this wonderful accomplishment that will usher you into this great community of lawyers. Congratulations, and God bless you.